I believe in the stars. And I believe in the spark. Said I believe in beating hearts. Said I believe that we're only getting started on the best part.
Hello and welcome to a series of podcasts with myself, James Campion, and a singer-songwriter, very close and dear friend of mine, and new daddy, still officially new daddy, Eric Hutchinson, as we discuss his brand new record, Before and After Life. So, I guess, for lack of a better intro, welcome to our own podcast.
Thank you for having us.
We're going to kick it off with the best part, first song on the record. So, what we do for these things, if you're familiar with the other series we have had, is that I take a bunch of notes and then I read them back so Eric can get the kick out of me interpreting this song. So he can tell me to shut up and I'm going to tell you the real deal, or he's going to be like, wow, I never thought of that. So that's what we're going to do, and I have some questions as I go along. But hopefully you out there in podcast land will maybe get something out of it. And Eric told me some great anecdotes about people listening to the prior podcast and listening to the songs anew and finding new ways to digest them. So I write about the best part, which, again, is the album's opening cut. And I will say one last thing as a precursor. Eric is very, as all the singer-songwriters that I've met over the years, very, very meticulous about how, where he puts songs and how he puts them in the record and the sequencing of them. This is even more important because this is a little tale, a little narrative going through the first part of the record, the first, what, four or five songs?
Five songs.
Five songs are about his expected daughter, Zelda. The best part kicks off the album in the first half, referring immediately to Before Life, with Eric's first thoughts on fatherhood and new life, new beginnings, a new world he will be entering. The album's directness, less ethereal and poetic, if not minimally metaphoric than Modern Happiness, is on display immediately in the first lines. Is this really happening? He asks. And are you really real? This album will not only be a departure musically, using jazz cats that you, Eric, had only just played with recently and specifically for these songs, but lyrically. Eric played with the reality versus fantasy on his previous record, and now we see he's in a world of discovery of and dealing with depression and medicating oneself against the tide of it. But here is something he's asking right away. Is this really real? And of course it is. It's a child. It's your child, a new human being, a blank slate, with none of the disease and confusion and all the things that were deconstructed on Modern Happiness. This is new. And to the songwriter's way of thinking, it is the best part of your life.
Is this really happening? And are you really real? We're looking at the plus sign and we're wondering how to feel. I'm an imperfection. My only guarantee, impossible to say how much you'd really mean to me.
Before I go on, I have to ask you, you kind of put a bow on everything you had been going through in the last couple of years with Modern Happiness.
Mm-hmm.
In the first lines of this song, new thing.
Interesting. Is this really happening? And are you really real? I think, for me, fatherhood, from the very first seconds we found out, I mean, that's what that moment is in the song, is we're looking at the plus sign and we're wondering how to feel. That's, you know, we just took the pregnancy test, and it's instant vulnerability as a parent.
If you want the lyrics, here they are.
Yeah, there we go. It's vulnerability, but I remember when I found out that Jill was pregnant, it was a very intense wash of warmth and calmness that came over me of like, this feels like the right thing to be doing right now. You know, it's felt right. So I was relieved by that. And I just found I had a lot to say and to think about this song. And so it sort of started coming out of that, of just sort of, it's a love song to sort of the whole experience and to my unborn daughter and to my wife who's about to become the mother of my daughter, and I don't know, you know, it's just a lot of vulnerable feelings all put in together.
Also, I will say the second part of that, before I go on, is that not only did you put a lock and key on the past with Modern Happiness, you confronted all these issues on a personal level. Now you're bringing in your wife and a child, and I noticed, and I will say, a little background info. Over the last couple of years, since I had a kid, and Eric would ask, "Well, what is that like?" You know, what it, and you know, the limitations. We're both artists. We both, you know, travel a lot. We both need isolation time to create. And I would say to you, "What are you guys thinking?" And you said, "I like my life the way I like traveling. I like doing this." So this is, in a way, you're saying this is going to be the best part. And we thought that was going to be really great, but this could be better too.
Yeah, I think so. And I think I call it the hazing. I think a lot in the beginning when we would tell people we were having a baby, there's sort of this like hazing thing that goes on with parents where they go like, "Oh, get your sleep now."
Yeah, exactly. And,
you know, this was sort of a pet peeve of mine. And people would say, "Oh, your life's over, blah, blah, blah." So this, I think, was also a little bit of a reaction to that of like, no, this is not going to be the end of my life. This is something new and exciting and different.
Everything was colder until you came along. A little heartbeat beating out a new familiar song. Idea. Started as a dream, soon to be a major motion picture on the screen.
Getting back to my notes, here we are again. As we just talked about, unlike the previous album, you're not in your head. But now you're commenting on something beyond the self. This is part of you, but it's also part of your wife. And thus, unlike dealing with personal issues, beyond our control. And through that, there is a brightness to the music, a new sense of style and tone, both musically and thematically. But of course, Eric is now coming to grips with all of this, as I did as an expectant father. And both of us being writers, and writers absolutely must be self-aware, he sings, "I'm an imperfection, my only guarantee." Like, all fathers go through this. I said to my wife, because my wife's like, "Well, I'm not sure we're going to keep..." My wife kept her name, right? Mm-hmm. So, and I said, "Well, give it one name. I don't want any dashes, so keep one mm-hmm. name." This was my theory. And she's like, "Oh," and then after a while, I finally said, "You're having her. She's a girl. She's part of you. I feel left out completely." My wife's like, "That's a good point. Well, she'll be a Campion." You know, so
there you go.
As a father, you do feel like, "Oh, geez, I'm a mess. What am I passing on?" But because you have no control over it, there's also a feeling of, "Oh, man, let's just see what happens."
Right. Yeah, I think there was that, and I think, you know, I've made a strong rule for myself going back to, I think I started at the beginning of Pure Fiction, was I wasn't allowed to write anything negative about myself. And this, I felt like Rick came right up to the line to say I'm an imperfection, but I felt it was more...
But who isn't?
Yeah, I felt it was more of a fact than a negative cut to me. But it was sort of how I felt of like presenting myself to this brand new thing of like, I'm not perfect. That was like the first thing I sort of thought, right, as, you know, the end of like, am I prepared for this, and what do I have to give, I guess.
Right. Yeah, and nobody is, of course. Getting back to the music, the vocal lines here, the melody in particular, is truly sublime, revealing joy, if not confused expression. What is happening here? I know this is the most important human event, this bringing a child into the world, but it's also magical and scary and a completely new experience for first-time parents, as Aaron and I were 10 years ago with Scarlett. Which I believe is brought to bear with the effusive phrasing. Also the use of no. Now, I know you're using no here when you sing no, 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 as sort of like a kind of like a jazz. That's what I noticed too, and I write this later. It's almost like you're part of the band in a way, some of the things you're singing, but you are using a word no. So I say, which is prevalent in the call and response with the wonderful horn part in the song. It's not listed in the lyrics, though, and I know it is a melodic device, but it's sung as if you're saying, "I can't believe this is happening."
No, 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 no. No, 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 no.
In an over refrain, so...
This is why you're so good at what you do, James. I like it.
Was that not a conscious? That was subconscious.
Certainly
thing.
Not a conscious thing.
Wow.
And like you said, I left it out of the lyrics I gave you. I think it just felt like something to sing, you know. But whatever.
No.
But it's no and not nah.
Yeah. It's like no, 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 no. You know. And what is he saying in there? And I think is, you know, and it's great because there is that's why I said it's like an instrument. The horns are playing off you. There's a great call and response.
No, 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 no. No, 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 no.
And I was very lucky enough to watch the horn players with you, Bartley, right, and Tucker, with you, as you sang with, you wanted them to play on another song. But I can almost picture the same kind of back and forth going on here.
Yeah, and that was, we talked about it in the introduction, but this is the first album I've ever done where I didn't use background vocals. And my instruction to them was really like, I want to use them like the background vocals.
Right, you know? The way Van Morrison did.
Yeah.
That's exactly how he did it. Good point. I continue, but this is probably my favorite melody on the record. I just want to come clean there. Eric even moves along to address the previous records, some of the songs that denote longing and, again, confusion on how he views life with the second verse. So I'll read it, if I may.
Sure.
And you could comment. Everything was colder until you came along, a little heartbeat beating out a new familiar song. You started as an idea. You started as a dream, soon to be a major motion picture on the screen. I like it because so is this album. An idea and a dream.
Right. I talk about heartbeats in a couple of songs, but in the beginning, that's all you. That's all the baby is to you, is a heartbeat. You know, like,
that was my reality when I heard that.
Yeah, for sure. I mean, it's a really moving thing, and but those moments where we went and got the ultrasounds and stuff were the moments where it was like actually happening. You know, because I was convinced we were going to go into the doctor's office after the, you know, because we said, we took a test, came out pregnant. They're like, great, come in like 8 weeks. And I was like, what? Or however long it was. And I was convinced we were going to go in there and they're going to say, oh, no, this is a mistake.
Right, right.
You know, April so fools. Like, yeah, hearing the heartbeat and all that stuff, it made it real. And I've talked a lot. I've been doing this stuff with my E-Hutch Club about songwriting. And this is a line that I really like. I had that line written down for a long time. It's just sort of a line, soon to be a major motion picture on the screen, you know, like they put that on books before they're going to be, when they want to be important and, you know, before they turn them into movies.
Godfather.
And they don't say soon to be a movie. They say a major motion picture. I just liked it. And, it's sort of how it felt of just like, this thing's in development and it's going to be bigger.
Sure. You know? That's good. And it's funny too, because you have all the makings of self-loathing and fear of a father, but also this idea, like, and later on we'll discuss it with ultrasound, where you're just going to make the greatest thing ever. This is going to be the greatest thing ever, and it's just going to be better than any song and better than any movie, because you're a movie guy, better than any city, because you live in the great city. It's like, you know, that's what you do as a dad. And you and as an artist, too, you foresee greatness within the structure of what you're doing.
Yeah, I think I felt a ton of optimism when we found out Jill was pregnant, and tried to capture as much of that as I could.
And I believe in the stars. And I believe in the spark. Said I believe in beating hearts. Said I believe that we're only getting started on the best part.
And there is, in the chorus, a sense of turning the page to get away from inside your head, as I said, to looking forward to not being this self-examining artist, but one who is looking beyond the horizon to things yet to come, and to quote-unquote believe, which you repeat as in a gospel refrain in this song. That, because it is a song of faith, in other words, you're looking into the future, you don't know what the heck it's going to be, you have to have some faith in that, you even sing, I begin to see the light. You have to believe these things will be great, when there's no guarantee, as you mentioned, of anything in the future. But there's also this blank slate, a white page that has yet to be written. And that, with all of your flaws, you keep being eternally hopeful. So you sing, and I believe in the start, and I believe in the spark, and I believe in the beating hearts, and I believe that we're only getting started on the best part. That is fantastic.
Thank you.
And it's not playing around poetically. It's not messing around with metaphor. It's not opaque. It's direct. And that's why I love that.
Thank you. And I had that melody of the chorus, and I believe, and I just didn't know what I was saying. And it took me a long time to finally get the best part. And that's what we're aiming towards. And then sort of the song quickly came together.
But the
lyrically.
Use of believe in there is spiritual, it's gospel. I'm not saying it's religious or there's even a faith in something that's going to happen.
No, I think you're right. There's faith in it.
Faith.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The first time that I saw you in fuzzy black and white, a little head and body, I begin to see the light. So now we do the waiting. I guess you're waiting too. A countdown to the moment when we're finally meeting you. No, 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 no. No, 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 no. And I believe, I believe, I believe in the stars. And I believe, I believe, I believe in the spark. And I believe, I believe, I believe in beating hearts. Said I believe, I believe, I believe that we're only getting started on the best part.
Tremendous thematic beginning to the record, but also musically, as the musicians here burst with the joy to herald something new in the composer's life and in this music. And this is a new sound and the new beginning. Or if not a beginning, a singular statement, separate from what has come before, with an eye on the future. And also, if I may, you spoke of being a parent starting as an idea and as a dream, and as you mentioned, for years wanting to do something like this, as I mentioned before, play with jazz cats, run your songs through the filter, and see what comes. So the song kind of reflects right off the bat what you're doing for the record and what you're doing in your life. Ba-ba. It's a great way to open the record, and I know how much that means to you as an opener. So was this always an opener, or how did you figure that?
I guess so. I mean, yeah, it felt like one of the earlier songs I wrote, maybe one of the first songs I wrote, and it's definitely the subject matter. It's the beginning of this stuff. It didn't make sense to put this song after other, you know, this is,
well, that's why it's
this
important.
Is the very beginning of the narrative.
Right, know? It's the beginning of the narrative. You just find out, you find out you're pregnant from pregnancy test, and then we go on to the next song, which will be Ultrasound, where, as you said, it becomes a reality.
Yeah, so I think the ordering of the first half is very much chronological, now that I think about it.
Yeah, well, it absolutely is, and we'll go through it. So that is the very first song, the best part. Again, my favorite melody on the record, and if you listen to the way Eric sings this, try to keep in mind he's doing, and the band is doing, everything they did exactly when it happened. And that's pretty darn cool. And so you, excuse me, as a listener, you are privy to something unique, because it's never going to happen again. When they say live to tape, this, that means it. So you're hearing it live. Even live albums are not live, but this is. So
yeah.
And I believe in the stars. I believe in the spark. And I believe, I believe in beating hearts. Said I believe that we're only getting started on the best part.